So a first question you might ask is, why do we do critical appraisal? Well, the reason is that around half of published studies contain some sort of bias that might affect their findings. Around half of studies don't get published, so there are lots of unpublished research out there, and often things don't get published because the results are uninteresting. So in this case, we'll be looking at a longitudinal population cohort study. So a sample was recruited in this case of the whole population in an area in the Netherlands. We take some measurements of that population, and we can then follow them forward over time and add more measurements, and then compare the different findings at different stages. And this gives us an idea of what features might be associated one with the other, such as your socioeconomic background and health outcomes. It also gives us the opportunity to see things developing over time. So population longitudinal cohort studies are a very valuable source of information. When it comes to critical appraisal, we need to think about some key aspects of these studies. So for example, what I've done here is I've highlighted, let's say, an imaginary subgroup of the population. I've coloured them pink. Now, let's say for one reason or another, that subgroup is less likely to engage with research. We might find that over time, they drop out, and so that the data set we end up with is different from the data set we started out with. I've summarised this as two concerns here: who takes part and who drops out. And we know that things like socioeconomic status, lower educational attainment, special educational needs, existing conditions such as depression and smoking, these all make it less likely for people to take part and to follow through with these population cohort studies. In this particular cohort study, the cohort was generally slightly healthier than the general population, so it tends to be slightly healthier people that followed through with the data. So that's something that you can't get around, but I think it's something that you need to just bear in mind when we're thinking about the results. We're also doing measurements, as we saw on that graph, and in this case we're measuring the association between gender diversity and mental health outcomes. The measure of this specific paper uses is R squared, or the coefficient of determination. All you really need to know about this is that it tells you what proportion of the variance in the mental health outcomes could be explained by variance in gender diversity experience. So as one goes up, the other goes up, as one goes down, the other goes down, that kind of thing.